What's happening with it? This is Slink Johnson, a.k.a. Black Jesus, your Lord and Savior, and you're listening to the Red Rock Podcast Network. How you love that?
You are listening to the Red Rock Podcast Network, featuring Pod of Thrones and
The Shiznit.
When you play the Game of Thrones, you win or you die. There is no middle ground.
Welcome back to another episode of the Pod of Thrones. I am your man. I am your host, the King in the West, King Dino Red. And I have with me, as always, my ride or die.
Ride or die.
Lord Latone Hart.
What is up? It is Lord Latone, Big Daddy Dothraki, also known as Let's Move the Fuck Out of King's Landing. These white bitches are tripping. Heart back in the building. What's up, man?
Yeah, what's up? What's up, man?
What is up, man? We are in the end game now.
Yeah, we are. You know, I want to say before we get into this, I'm surprised at how the internet is a little upset about the, you know,
man, the internet is a bunch of idiots that want to complain about everything. I get so tired of people. Don't watch. Like, read a book, you know, get a second job.
Did you hear about they have a petition going around from change.org? Yeah. They got 33,000 signatures. They want them to redo the whole eighth season.
Find someone to have sex with. Have an affair. Have a midlife crisis. Do something other than complain about a fantasy TV. It's a fantasy TV show.
The thing that's funny to me is that up until this last episode, number 5, you know, people were like, every episode that's showing up, people were happy about it. Then this episode shows up, then all of a sudden the whole season needs to be done over. Like, what? The whole season?
And I know why. And we'll discuss that a little bit. There's a simple explanation.
I'm like, well, I have to say that as far as episodes go, it wasn't my favorite. I didn't hate it. And it wasn't my favorite, though. And a lot of the reason why I didn't care for it, it wasn't about the writing or the story or any of that stuff. There were some things that happened that I wasn't crazy about, but I got to explain it. Sometimes, you know, you want things to go a certain way because you're a fan or you're rooting for it or whatever, but it doesn't always go that way. And I'm okay with that. I mean, that's part of the game, part of the fun. I'm okay with that. I'm not upset about that, you know.
Yeah.
I didn't care for the actual directing of the episode. A lot of the directorial, the creative choices that this particular director used to tell the story. I wasn't a fan of that. That's what I didn't like.
I thought it had some great shots. Mm-hmm. I mean, I'm not like anybody's master or anybody's coach on directing, but I thought it was master shots. Well, I think I saw you say something about that earlier, and I was hoping you'd elaborate. Like, give me an example. What piece of directing did you like?
In particular, I didn't like the long pauses, the long moments of silence, the long kind of almost like slow motion, but not really slow motion. Like, I can give you an exact moment. The time when Arya, when she was going towards the white horse, it seemed like it took forever, and there was like nothing else really going on. It was kind of like there was like hardly any sound at all. It was just kind of like time was at a standstill. I didn't care for that at all. And he did that a couple of times in that episode, and I did not like it.
Did you think those were done for purpose? See, I thought the whole episode was meant to convey a message of dread and despair the whole episode. That's why there wasn't a whole lot of music. Even the music they had was really low, and was really, because they played the Reigns of Castamere in there, but it was slow.
Yeah.
You had to really, you know, I think the whole thing was meant to feel like this is fucked up.
Right. Well, for me, what that did, instead of me feeling like, oh, this is fucked up, I was already feeling that way. And when he did that, it just reminded me of, see, I'm old school. You know, the way I came up and you know, when, you know, because I actually went to school for this shit. And,
yeah, I know.
And we were taught, like, anything that reminds you or reminds the viewer that they're watching a movie or a TV show and takes them out of the moment, then it's not particularly something that you want to do. And that's what it did. To me, it reminded me that this is not real, that this is, you know, that you're watching something. Like, that moment, that's what it did. It took me out of the moment. Instead of put me more into it, it took me out of it. It did the opposite.
Well, that must be something to do with your film training, because I was glued in. I was sucked in like, oh, shit. I was like really sucked in.
Yeah.
So.
Well, but other than that, though, that was my major concern, things with, as far as directing wise, story wise, as we go along, there's a couple of things that I wasn't crazy about that I'll pick out. But overall, you know, like, as far as like doing the whole season, I'm like, well, I don't know what the hell they talking about. Because,
well, this is the Pod of Thrones, season 8, episode 5 is what we're talking about, called The Bells.
The Bells. And rock the bells.
And the episode starts where we hear a bunch of characters talking about Targaryen heritage. We hear them talking about flipping the coin, and you don't want to wake the dragon, and be a dragon, and this and that. And we hear all that before we even get to the show starting. And we start with a scene with Varys acting like Ned Stark. He's writing letters to the realm about the true heir. He's writing mad letters.
Yes.
He's writing mad letters. And then one of his little birds, I guess he's back on it. He's got his birds. He's working. You know, I always thought that was a little weird, Varys with the little kids and stuff. Nobody ever said anything about that.
Yeah, that's kind of creepy. A little creepy.
Yeah. But he's like, you know, one of his little birds is like, she won't eat. And, you know, Khaleesi's not stupid. She knows these little birds are trying to go BBD on her and trying to poison her. She's like, no, I'm not eating that shit. Little girl's like, she's watching me. Yeah, we watching you. We know it ain't crazy. You know, she ain't crazy. And, of course, your boy John arrives, and Varys meets him on the beach right away. Says, man, your girlfriend's crazy. Your girlfriend's crazy, man. You'd be a better king. And I never got why Varys did this. I mean, he knows they're watching him.
Yeah.
He knows they're watching his little birds. You know, sadly, Varys is the only one that sees the truth. Maybe that's because he sat behind her at the cafeteria in Winterfell, and he heard her say something. I don't know. I have no idea. Men decide where power resides, whether they know it or not, which is kind of a quote he said. He said something like that before. Was it season 4? What did he say? Power, it's a trick. Shadow on the wall.
Yep.
Something, I remember, like, he told that. A story about the sellsword, the king, and something else.
Yeah, who really has the power? I remember the little parable.
Yeah, a little parable.
Yeah.
Of course, she's my queen to be. John is not letting it go. He's like, you know, she's my queen, and I don't want to be king, and she's the queen, and we're gonna deal with her. And of course, Tyrion is watching, because Tyrion is a snitch.
Snitches get stitches.
Run tell that. He's going to run tell that to Daenerys. Yep. And then, you know, we get to Daenerys, and she's looking fucked up. But she's like, you all betrayed me. Jon, Sansa, Tyrion, LeBron, Varys, Beyonce.
Yeah, she just started naming everybody. Like, she was like, everybody. Dino Red, Tone Hart, all y'all.
Oprah Winfrey, everybody, everybody betrayed me.
Everybody.
Everybody betrayed me.
Yeah.
And Daenerys, she looked really sick. I mean, and really thin. I thought her brother Viserys was back. She was looking real fucked up.
Yeah, yeah.
Like, I guess she ain't been eating.
She can't afford to skip meals, you know.
She could afford it.
No, she can't. And,
but I felt bad for Daenerys, because, you know, when a woman has an event coming up and her hairdresser cancels, she's all fucked up. She's all pissed off. And Missandei, that was like her hairdresser. So you ever dealt with a woman and you know, her hairdresser cancels on her, she's you know, she's running around last second trying to find somebody because they get this relationship with their hair people that's, you know, they get a hairdresser they really like. They don't like the switch.
Yeah, that's true.
And, you know, and that's why Daenerys is in there jacked up. Of course, Varys is hearing the Isley brothers. I hear footsteps in the dark. And, of course, young Obama arrives at the gate.
Mm-hmm.
And shout out to Varys. He's the first Kinkos in Westeros. He's doing 11 copies a day by hand with a pen at night. You know what I'm saying? It had to start somewhere.
So I like the way he knew what was going on. Like, he was prepared. He started burning shit, evidence, and hiding stuff and getting ready to go, taking off watches, took off his watch and his jewelry.
he took off all his rings. Shout out, you know, Varys didn't go out like no bitch. He was like, whatever.
Yeah,
he was like, I know it's coming. Now, let me go ahead and let me hide this evidence. Go on out there. Of course, Varys is out there. They take him to the cliffs where he meets Judge Dredd Daenerys, and you know, she's like, hey, I told you if you betrayed me, you know, this is what I do.
Yep.
And I kind of thought it was like kind of fucked up that Tyrion was like, I told on you, nigga.
Well, I think I think Tyrion was just trying to be honest about it, you know, like
it was me, man. You know, you're about to die. It was me. I thought I was fucked up. I don't like the fuck away from you, man. And what the fuck is Drogon a stealth bomber? This motherfucker. Where the fuck did he come from? He's out here avoiding radar and shit. That's why he can't get hit, because he just came out of nowhere.
Yeah, when he did that, my wife was like, that's what she should do. She should attack him at night. You can't even see him.
Your wife is right.
Yeah, is right. That's what I told her. I was like, that is a good idea. That is a very good idea.
So now we got charbroiled spider. And that makes John wonder if Danny is losing it. I'm sure he thought about Sam. But, you know, John's like, hey, I made a choice. So I'm going to stick with it. And it's just Daenerys and young Obama are in a room together, and Daenerys gives young Obama Missandei's last little piece. What is that, a little collar or something like that? What is it?
That slave collar that she had when she was still a slave.
Man, I just thought she was into S&M, and that's why he was really pissed. You know, he's fucking freak on her anymore, man.
That was her slave collar that she had saved.
He, like, gets choked a little bit, 50 Shades of Grey style. I thought, oh, okay.
Well, that too.
When you find a freak, it is hard, you know, to replace a freak. You're like, man, I used to be the shit, man. You know, she used to do all types of freaky shit. Like, where am I find that again? John comes to Daenerys, and Daenerys tells Grey Worm, you know, he can leave. And John is not with it. John is, I forgot my Cialis Snow. He refuses to console her. He refuses to hug her, kiss her, you know, and she can... She feels rejected. You know, she already feels betrayed. Now she feels rejected.
Yeah.
It's not a good thing, man.
Asked him, like, is that all I am, is your queen? And John didn't say nothing.
I am is your queen. I can't be your side chick. I can't be nothing.
I can't be your homie lover friend no more.
Homie lover friend. You out there banging R. Kelly. Daenerys is trying to prove who's the real Targaryen. She's 100% down for that incest. She's ready to go ahead. You know, she doesn't give a damn.
Yeah, she's like, our motto is incest is best.
Incest is best. I want inbred babies. I don't. This is basically a victory for Sansa. And I know Daenerys is like, I should have burnt her ass up about a week ago.
Right.
Like, I should have been burnt her ass up. I know. And I think this is the moment where she decided, shit, you know, I don't have love here. I only have fear. So she says, let it be fear. So that's, yep.
I wish we knew where John's head is at. Like, I want to know in that moment where he didn't return her affections, if it was like a combination of the fact that she's his aunt and the way she's been acting, or if it's strictly because of the way she's been acting, he don't care about the fact that she's his aunt. Because I think it is, because if I remember correctly, I don't know if they had sex, but I believe they kissed and stuff since he's found out about, you know, her being his aunt.
Well, it doesn't really seem like they've had sex since they went flying the dragons up to the fucking waterfall.
Right. It doesn't seem like it. It's kind of hard to tell, but
I think he kissed her, but you know, he ain't really been down with it.
No. So I just kind of wish they would kind of like make that, because I'm a little, you know, not sure where his head is at exactly. I know he's not happy with her right now.